Amen. Thank you. I want to say a word about Christmas Eve. We are having services here at our regular schedule. We're going to have services at 5, 7, 9, and 11 here at this campus, and also at 7 at our Boone campus. We hope we'll be out of the red zone in our county and maybe into the orange or even yellow. But we're going to have those services regardless, and they're going to be live streamed. So if you're part of the online community, you can just watch that where you are. But if you want to come to this location, we're going to have overflow set up all throughout the building, all the TVs, all around the building will be working, and we'll have opportunity for you to do that. So we think between the mini services and the overflow opportunities, we don't need to do reservations or other things like that. But be mindful of how that crowd tends to be, 7 and 9 or greater than 11 and 5. So just be mindful of that. But we hope you'll come and maybe invite your friends and neighbors to join you on Christmas Eve as well. So we're grateful for your presence here with us today. So our scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter, verses 5 through 25. So look in your bulletins or in your own Bibles or online and join in the scripture with me. Hear now the word of God. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijab, and his wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless, because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty, and he was serving as a priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before their Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now let us pray together. Holy Spirit, come now and do what only you can do, which is to take this time and use it to accomplish your purpose in our lives, to speak into the still places of our hearts and minds and spirit, to help us tune out the noise of the world and to be silent enough to trust you and to listen to what you would say. So speak through me in spite of me, but help us all to hear this truth that can set us free. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. A young rookie comic was attending his first comedian's convention. He was very excited to be sitting among the comics that he'd grown up watching on TV. The proceedings began with a joke session. A veteran comic stood up and just said, "Number 64. And everybody in the place laughed hilariously, except this rookie. He turned to the older comedian who'd brought him and said, "I didn't hear a joke. Why was that everyone laughing?" His friend replied, "These are for professional comedians, and they don't need to hear the jokes. They know them so well, they've given every joke a number. They just get up and say the number. It saves time." Next, another veteran got up and said, "Number 145, and everybody in the place cracked up. "Could I try it?" the young man said. "Of course." So this rookie stood up and said, "Number 15, and nobody laughed. And from the end of his table, he heard someone say, "Well, some people just don't know how to tell a joke." Now, I'm usually one of those people. Actually, I just need better material or newer material because that joke's older than I am. It's hard to laugh at the same old jokes or to be enthralled at the same old stories. It's often said that familiarity breeds contempt, but I think most of the time it just breeds indifference. What becomes too familiar is sometimes something that we become apathetic about. And so one of the challenges every Christmas for most people is to hear again the same old stories that we've heard so many times. And when you see it in a kind of a different angle, to maybe appreciate its truth even more. So this Advent season, we're looking at the cast of Christmas, those characters that made up that first Christmas stories. And these people are so familiar to us that we forget what they were like before they became famous. And if we were casting for a pageant that would change the world, we probably wouldn't pick these people because most of them were broken or discarded or marginalized. That means God's greatest miracle came into the world through the lives of unlikely people. In other words, people like you and people like me. And I believe there's a lesson in that. Pastor Ray McKelvey says, God uses the unlikely to accomplish the impossible. God uses the unlikely to accomplish the impossible. I agree. I like the way the Message paraphrases 1 Corinthians chapter 26, verses 26 through 29. Take a good look, friends, at you, who you were when you got called into this life. I don't see many of the brightest and best among you, not many influential, now many from high society families. Isn't it obvious that God deliberately chose men and women that the culture overlooks and exploits and abuses, chose these nobodies to expose the hollow pretensions of the somebodies? God chooses the unlikely to accomplish the impossible. Because then when it happens, people say, how did that happen? And if they're going to make the best conclusion, let's say, it must be God. God showed up. God did that. And if they draw that conclusion, that they might draw them to the one who can do the impossible in their lives. This morning, we look at the story of an older couple named Zechariah and Elizabeth. And the fact that they were older probably means that they were marginalized a little bit already. People, I think, of age were respected more in that culture maybe than they are now, but they probably feel out of it, not up to current events, not ready for the challenges of life. However, the real pain for this couple was not their age, but the fact that they had remained childless throughout their marriage. The most common word for this in biblical times is the word barren. It's in the Greek, but we don't put it in our New Testament English Bibles anymore because it's an offensive word to many people. It means unable to bear and give birth to your own child. But it means more than that. I want to expand on the idea of barrenness because we all struggle with barren times and situations. Each of us knows something about fruitlessness, about brokenness, about disappointment, about emptiness and failure. Most of us know more about it than we did this time last year, right? We knew more about being in the wilderness this year than we did before. Now, the word barren, it was used several ways in the Bible, but it's always a word that conjures up images of brokenness and disappointment. In terms of the land, it was said to be barren when it couldn't produce any fruit. And if you've been to the Middle East or seen pictures of the Middle East, you know it is an often arid and desert place without much fruitfulness. So whenever life finally does spring forth, it's not taken for granted. It's celebrated as a miracle. Moses was leading the people through their wilderness time in a barren, barren place. They were dying of thirst. He cried out to God, "These people are dying, help me." And God said, "Strike a rock and water will come out." And water came out in the desert. And forever since, the Hebrew people have said, God brings life out of barren places. God brings life out of barren places. And all the kinds of barrenness one could experience, childlessness was perhaps the worst for biblical Jews. We don't often talk about this, but many Jews then and now don't believe in the kind of afterlife we believe in. The resurrection became much more popular after Jesus was actually resurrected, but they didn't believe. They thought, in fact, the way they lived on was through their legacy, the faithfulness they passed on, their culture, their heritage, the way they continued to possess the land. All of that was what they were looking forward to. And so you couldn't do any of that if you didn't have any children, if you were barren, and that was a hopeless kind of word. And in spite of all their heartaches, they went on with life as best they could. They went on being righteous, the passage says, which means they went on trusting God. And so Zechariah was a priest. The priest served in the temple on a rotating schedule. When your team was up, the particular job you were going to play at that time was drawn by lots. In other words, they'd pull your name out of a hat. And if your number was up, you got to have the best job. The highest position was to go inside the temple to the place that only the priest could go, inside the temple, and offer incense on the special altar there. And then you could come out and share a benediction with everybody. And it was a high honor. And many people never got chosen. Their whole careers, they never got chosen. So now Zechariah is very old. He'd never been selected. I suspect he thought that time had passed. How everything changed for him one day. Time was set to serve. The assignments were given out. His number comes up. His name is drawn out. He's joyful. But then he gets something he didn't expect. Because inside the temple, the angel of God appeared to Zechariah with the news that he and his wife were going to be parents. And not just the parents of any ordinary child, but the parents of the one we would come to know as John the Baptist, the forerunner of the Messiah. Barrenness was replaced with blessing. Now, the reason we should find all this interesting is because, as I've said, we've all gone through seasons of barrenness in our lives. We have some kind of brokenness and pain. Maybe it's childlessness, like Elizabeth. Maybe it's having a child, but being alienated from that child, and that breaks your heart every day. Maybe it's divorce or separation. Maybe it's a long-lasting marriage that's only held together by a kind of passive-aggressive truce. Maybe it's loneliness and grief that come as a result of losing someone you love. Maybe it's a physical problem that makes you feel like a burden to other people. Maybe it's being bullied or marginalized or feeling left out in some way. Maybe it's public failure or the fear that your private failures will become public. Maybe it's feelings of insecurity and inferiority and worthlessness. Maybe it's financial instability that makes you feel like you can never get ahead. Maybe it's rumors that destroy or doubts that discourage or guilt and shame that rob you of your joy. I hope you get the idea. We all have, or we have had, or we will have seasons of barrenness, wilderness, wanderings in our life. So we're going to learn from the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth. First of all, you are not forgotten. You are not forgotten. Elizabeth and Zechariah must have felt that God had forgotten them, or God didn't care about them at all. And it's tempting in a time of pain to say we're all alone, but it's not true. No matter what you feel, there are things that are objectively true, whether you recognize them or not. And the fact is, we are not alone. God is with us and God is for us. I can testify from the lives of Elizabeth and Zechariah and all the other biblical characters, and in my own life, in the lives of hundreds of people that I've known, we are not alone and we are not forgotten by God. And we ought to be honest, sometimes we don't feel like that. We see other people getting blessed in the way we hope to be blessed, and we conclude God must love them and not love me. But again, that's just not true. God just has a different plan for them, a different timeline for them than he does for you. And so you need to learn to live in righteousness, which means to trust in spite of the circumstances, in spite of appearances. We are not forgotten by God. Just because we feel forgotten doesn't mean we are. In fact, Christmas ought to be a declaration that you're not forgotten by God, that the world is not forgotten by God. There are many decorations all around, and people have all sorts of reasons for hanging up their decorations. Sometimes crass materialism, just kind of secular tradition or habit, but it ought to be a sign to you that God is declaring, I love you, I care about you. In fact, I came from heaven to earth in the form of Christ to offer salvation to all who would trust in me. Christmas is the story of God remembering and keeping his promises. The nation of Israel had been promised a Messiah 400 years before he showed up. There's a lot of living and dying. It's a lot of waiting. That's a lot of prayers. It would have been easy to conclude that God had quit working on their behalf, but he had not. He had a plan for good, a plan for blessing. And that plan was fulfilled in the coming of Christ, who was born to die as a sacrifice for our sins, to mend all that is broken, to reconcile us to God. We may not see the big picture now, and it may not be similar to this picture, but God's working, and God's got a plan, and God's plan for you is good. Now, please note that God blesses us sometimes in unexpected ways. That means we don't always get what we ask for. We don't always get what we're expecting. Sometimes we get something much bigger and much better. And the blessing may come in this life. Sometimes it comes in the next life, but God is always working. I mean, I've been clinging to that passage in Romans this year. For God is working in all things for the good of those who love him, and are called according to his purpose. Just because you don't appreciate yet his advent, advent means coming, he doesn't mean he's not well on his way. Well on his way to come and meet you at your point of need. You are not forgotten by God. Now, second, God's plan for our lives often takes us through a wilderness, a painful training ground. Why? Because God is preparing us for more than this life. He's preparing us for eternity. This life, this existence, is just a sliver of our existence compared to the weight of eternity. And in the midst of that, it says in the Bible that Jesus learned obedience through what he suffered. And that's often the case for God's people. Moses wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. David was chased around all over Israel by King Saul for many years. Abraham waited decades before the child of promise would be born. The apostles endured various hardships of all sorts of kinds. God's people are often taken through a wilderness, a training ground, and in our times of barrenness. We've got to be open to the possibility that God's doing something in us now that's preparing us for something he's going to do later. Think of it like this. Maybe you had a class in school that you just hated, but you had to take it. It was a required course, and you just kind of suffered through it. When I started out in college, I studied business administration, and I even did a six-month internship in a government agency in Washington, D.C., and I hated every minute of it. I wasn't called to that life. God bless the people who are. It wasn't for me. And when I got called finally into the ministry, I thought all of that suffering was for nothing. And then I had to kind of help lead a church that's got budgets and staff and all that, and I've been grateful for that education ever since. God used that painful time in my life to prepare me for fruitfulness at a later time in my life. God uses the trials of life to deepen our faith and to deepen our experiences to prepare us to trust him more. There's an old poem by an anonymous author that reflects the way God often works in people. It's entitled, When God Wants a Man. And of course, it's written old-fashioned, so it uses that masculine language, but it just means humanity, humankind. So women read that into that. So it's relevant to all. It says, when God wants to thrill a man and drill a man and skill a man, when God wants to mold a man to play the noblest part, when he yearns with all his heart to create so great and bold a man that all the world shall praise, watch his methods, watch his ways, how he ruthlessly perfects whom he royally elects, how he hammers him and hurts him, and with mighty blows converts him into frail shapes of clay that only God understands, how he uses whom he chooses, and with every purpose fuses him, and by every art induces him to try his splendor out. God knows what he's about. The first time I heard that poem, I hated it. The idea of God allowing or using my pain for his purpose was distasteful because I didn't want challenge. I wanted comfort. But it took me a long time to learn that I've learned more through the challenging times of life than I have through the comforting times of life. I've come to see on my good days that hardship is often a kind of blessing because in that time of challenge, there's going to be preparation for greater fruitfulness. Now, third, we need to wait on God in prayer. We need to wait on God in prayer during the barren times of life. A couple of weeks ago, Jacob Boer preached in our contemporary service on the November 29th contemporary service. If you haven't seen that, you should go online and watch that. He did an outstanding job. He's gifted in that way. I was blessed by that. But he said in the sermon that he grew up in this church, and all the time he noticed that all the preachers had 3 points to their sermons. So he was going to follow suit and have 3 points. I've told him this when he was here in the earlier services. I'm going to show him a kind of pro tip, and that is my third point has 4 sub-points. So you can expand. And then he got me back because after the service he said, you know, I remember those 4 points when you preached that 8 years ago because I wrote it in the margin of my Bible. And I said, well, another tip is this. If it was worth preaching once, it's worth preaching twice. And so here we go. The 4 tips. 4 things you want to do as you wait on God in prayer. First of all, you need to wait for God to answer in his own time. That means according to his schedule and his timetable. In other words, whenever God thinks it's best. So Zechariah was skeptical because he waited so long for an answer that hadn't come. Even when an angel came to him with a message, he was doubtful. How can I be sure of this? Hello, it's an angel. And when an angel shows up, you ought to listen. Instead, he said, I'm an old man and my wife is well along in years. Basically said, we gave up. We gave up on that prayer a long time ago, but they didn't realize God hadn't given up on them. We got to be willing to let God answer our prayers in his own time. And so the angel said, do not be afraid, Zechariah, Your prayer has been heard. I believe our prayers are heard the moment they're uttered, and they're even answered immediately. But sometimes we got to wait years to discover the answer God has given to that prayer. We got to learn to wait upon the Lord. And that's a hard thing to do for any time. But I think it's particularly hard for American people. We've had so much success. We've gotten so used to things being done quickly. Drive-through, throwaway, information, superhighway culture. I remember as a kid, I would order things off the back of comic books, whether they be seeds that I could sell door to door or sea monkeys in a glass jar. And it would say every time 6 to 8 weeks, and it was never six. It was 8, 9, 10 weeks. And you just waited. I ordered something on Amazon last week that said it would take 10 days. It took 2 days to come. We've gotten used to all of that, which means we've forgotten how to wait. So one of the reasons this season is so challenging for us, I think, in America, is we think we're kind of above all this suffering that everybody else in the rest of the world goes through. We're going to be successful. We're going to come out on top. We're going to do that in all rapid succession. We're lost our ability to just wait, to just wait through challenging seasons of life. The Apostle Paul says in Hebrews 6, we need to be imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises of God, who through faith and patience inherit the promises of God. Now, why does God wait? I don't know. And I got to tell you, I don't like it most of the time. But what I've learned is that sometimes I'm just not ready. I'm not ready. Things aren't ready. The situation's not unfolded in the way that's going to be best for what God's agenda is and all of our lives put together. Sometimes we're just not ready. Suppose your 10-year-old child comes to you and says, I want to drive a car. What are you going to say? If you're a good parent, you're going to say, no way, you're not ready yet. One day you'll drive the car, but not right now. You got to wait until the child is ready. And sometimes God waits, but God's delays are not God's denials. Now, sometimes God just says no. You got to understand that sometimes we ask for things. We don't know what we want, what we need. And so we ask, and God says, no, that's not good for you. We get a no, but sometimes we get a not yet. And no, not yet doesn't mean no, it means not yet. And until you get a clear no from God, just keep praying and keep waiting and keep watching to see what God's going to do. Now, second, we need to wait for God to answer in his own way. Not just whenever he thinks is best, but also however he thinks is best. In Isaiah 55, God says, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so much am I different than you? God delays his answer to our prayers because he has a bigger picture in mind and he's working things out on a grander scale. Now, what would have happened in the story if God had just answered the prayer of Elizabeth and Zechariah to have a child when they were younger? They would have had a nice little child and they would have had a beautiful little Jewish family. That would have been wonderful. But God delayed the granting of this request for a number of years until the child would be born, closely preceding the birth of Christ. And so when God answered their prayer, he didn't give them just any ordinary baby. He gave them John the Baptist, the last prophet, the one prophet that saw the prophecies about the Messiah fulfilled before his very eyes. And Jesus said, among those born of women, there's not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. And oftentimes our problem is this, we ask for too little, and we want it too quick instead of waiting for God to answer in his own time and in his own way. And third, we need to be willing to let God answer in his own power. Sometimes we lose our patience and we just kind of take matters into our own hands and we make a mess of things. We need to learn to wait. Now, when did God give Elizabeth and Zechariah a baby? When they were old in advanced years. In other words, when it was humanly impossible. And oftentimes that's the way God works. We have to get to that place of desperation. Not so much God wants us to experience desperation, but it's desperation that leads us to say, I got nothing. I can't do this. God, unless you act, nothing's going to happen. And that's a person God can use. And so he got to this place of helplessness. And again, he acted because they trusted him in that moment of surrender. A similar thing happened in the life of Sarah and Abraham. God gave to Abraham a promise. You're going to be the father of a great nation. And he thought, that's great. But in order to do that, I've got to have a child. And so he wanted to have a child. They tried to have a child. They couldn't have a child. And they waited decades for a child. And then he got to the age of 86. And he said, maybe I've got to prime the pump here somehow. And so he got Hagar, his wife's servant. And he made her pregnant. And she had a child named Ishmael, who became the father of the Arab nations that gave birth to the religion of Islam. And I personally believe that many of the ongoing conflicts of the Middle East are the ongoing consequences of Abraham's lack of patience. He should have waited. Finally, God said, that's not my plan. Let me do it in my time, my way, my power. And so finally, when he's 99 and Sarah's 96, then God shows up and gives them the child Isaac to fulfill his promise. The point is, again, God waits till humanly impossible. We say, who did that? God. We see God act most clearly. So do you want an answer from God? Wait for God to answer in his own time. Wait for God to answer in his own way. And wait for God to answer in his own power. And then last, we need to wait for God to answer for his own purpose. So not only whenever, however he wants, but for whatever reason he chooses. So again, how did he answer the prayer for a son? He gave him John the Baptist. He gave him John the Baptist at that time because he wanted him to grow up in a godly home. He was preparing them and this child for a grander purpose. Another example of what I'm thinking about is in the life of the Apostle Paul. We read in the book of Romans how he said his prayer concern. One of the things I always pray for is the opportunity, God willing, to come at last to see you in Rome. I'm eager to come to you in Rome to preach God's good news. Did God ever answer that prayer? Yeah, he got to go to Rome, but it took a long time. And then when he got there, I don't think it was what he imagined. In Acts chapter 28, it says, when he got to Rome, he was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. So when he got to Rome, he was under house arrest, under guard, waiting for a trial before Caesar, under the threat of death, which was carried out, not exactly the opportunity to preach that he so desired, but he trusted God and he accepted the plan of God. He wanted to go to Rome to preach. Why did God want him to go? I think God wanted him to go to write letters. Because when he was in Rome under house arrest, he had a lot of time on his hands. He wrote a bunch of letters that went all throughout the Mediterranean, many of which make up a lot of what's in our New Testament. So instead of reaching 100, maybe thousands even of Roman people at that time, God used him to reach millions, billions of people all around the world, including you and including me. And the last thing I want to say is this. As you're waiting on God in prayer, which I know is not easy, as you're waiting on God in prayer through whatever season of barrenness you're enduring, I want you to remember the words the angel spoke this time to Mary, the mother of Jesus. He said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. Behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. For nothing will be impossible with God. We need to wait. We need to keep on praying. We need to keep on trusting God until we see and believe what the angel said is true. Nothing is impossible with God. Let us pray. Almighty God, help us join the cast of so many other stories you've told through history, stories recorded in the Bible, stories told in Christian history, stories that are going on even now in all kinds of places in the world. Help us to know that sometimes we're in a part of the story that's just challenging and it's just difficult, but it doesn't mean it's the end of the story. You're still working, you're still writing, you're still preparing another chapter in our lives. And even in the midst of those chapters, there's opportunities for blessing. There's opportunity to serve. There's opportunity to give. There's opportunity to grow. So help us in the midst of all the seasons of life to trust in you, to pray and to wait for your will to be done, not ours, but for your will be done. Help us to grow in this season to be more faithful people who are not using you as the means to the end of another plan or another agenda or another kind of definition of success, but view faithfulness as what you are due, faithfulness of what you're worthy of, that faithfulness is its own reward. Help us just to choose faithfulness, and that's the righteousness that was in Zechariah and Elizabeth. Help us to choose faithfulness, and then we'll walk by faith until we walk by sight, and we'll see that all your promises are true. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.